And now for your weekly dose of metal. Here are your hosts, Morgan Danielle and Luco Blaze, on The Metal Experience.
We just heard The Cold by Beyond Death, and that's off the record Age of Darkness, which is out now on Vorgeist Records. The band is also playing both Armageddon Fest Deuce, November 2nd at Penny Road Pub, which we're sponsoring, and Forever Death Fest, December 6th at the Beat Kitchen in Chicago. And then we heard a song, Demons, with the S in parentheses, and that was by Urzuli. Fuck yeah. I am Luco Blaze with Morgan Danielle. We're sitting in the back of Fits of Spare Keys, rocking out with the boys from the Eldritch Grimoire. I got through it. Why don't you guys go ahead and introduce yourselves? What you do in the band? Who's missing tonight?
Well, I'm Rich. I play bass.
I'm Will. I make really weird noises into microphones.
I'm Steve. I play lead guitar.
And the people missing tonight are our rhythm guitar player, Justin, who's going to hate that I called him our rhythm guitar player, and our drummer, Chance. Chance had to work, and Justin, I guess, just had better things to do.
What a vagina.
Well, I mean, if you're not here, then you're the second best guitarist, right?
I mean, that's an unrefuted fact.
Hard facts.
Hard facts.
Hard facts.
So before we dive into this interview, I wanted to kind of go over how you guys came to be on this show. So there was a post that Will made at the toward the end of last year that I had noticed that he tagged The Metal Experience in, saying that his New Year's resolution was to get his band on The Metal Experience.
It was.
Which, I'm not going
to
lie,
you just talk to Rich?
No one has ever like posted that, and I thought that was very flattering, and I was like, okay, now we got to do this, because I was like, that's pretty fucking cool.
So here's the funny thing. Like, I knew Opatia had been on The Metal Experience before, because
that's
Rich's other band, for anybody that doesn't
know.
Yeah,
let's just brag about it, Rich.
Yeah.
It's one of his other 43 bands.
For real.
It's great, though, honestly.
Yeah, we love Opatia. But I knew Opatia had been on. It just didn't click to me, and I had actually just got done listening to one of the podcasts. I don't remember who the fuck was on it, but I just finished listening, and I'm like, God, I want to do this so fucking bad. And I just kind of made a post about it, hoping, I guess, that something came out of it.
The thing is, like, he made the post, and I just commented, like, me, I've been on. I know Morgan and Luco,
and like, I'm like, oh fuck, yeah, that's right. Shit. Oh God, I'm so embarrassed. This is awful. And then I went and hid in my bathroom for 4 hours and cried.
Well,
I mean, that's an average Wednesday night for you.
But I remember going like, Luco, did you see this? Like, this person wants his band on his New Year's. I thought that was awesome. So yeah, I hit you up, and I was like, let's make this happen. I mean, like, this is like literally like 10 months ago. So, I mean, I was way in advance. And then yesterday when you posted, like, I've been waiting months for this, I'm like, to meet us? Like, I mean, this is going to be a shit show with us arguing and in between all these dumb comments.
I mean, I'm an easy person to please, so.
Yeah, Luca's not.
What are we talking about? Give me some tacos and some Modelo's and I'm good.
He makes it seem easy, but I was
well,
very...
Well, Morgan, I've been waiting for 3 weeks for my goddamn Creature from the Black Lagoon wall mount, and it still hasn't gotten here.
It's not a wall mount. It's a lawn decoration that you want to put on the wall. But
it's going on the wall.
Besides that fact...
It sounds lit.
Now you're here.
It's pretty sweet.
And we're thrilled that you wanted to be on our show so bad. So, hey, we're making it happen. And so, yeah, now we can get
you're
into
here.
All that fun
it's
stuff.
Official.
I guess
yeah.
It's official.
So
we
now
are
you
here.
Can talk about everything you wanted to tell us about your band.
Oh my
we
God.
Suck.
It all started.
They sucked
in
before
the,
me, before I came in.
That's true. We sucked horribly before Steve joined the band. Like, we were on the brink of actually breaking.
I was only in the band for like 2 weeks before Steve joined, so.
We were like on the brink of breaking up before these two joined the band, so like they kind of like breathed new life into us. So, and that's not, I'm not even like joking there. That was something we were seriously like considering, because we weren't gaining any traction and we felt like things weren't going the way we wanted it to. And we had sat down and we were like, you know, do we want to keep doing this or what do we want to do? Like, obviously something's not working. And, yeah, everything just kind of fell together. I'll tell the story about how I got these two in the band a little later, but
How long have you been a band first?
So, that's kind of a long story. I've been working with our other guitar player Justin for almost 10 years. We went to high school together. We started jamming together probably late 2010, early 2011. We were on and off jamming with one another. We started another band that I'm not going to talk about for reasons that I'll explain when we're not on air.
They sucked.
It's not that. There's a lot that went into that, and I don't want it to be associated with the Eldritch Grimoire, so I'm not going to talk about it. But I was in a band with him with that for a while. I moved to Florida. I was in Florida for 3 years. And as I was moving back to Illinois, because I was coming back for work opportunities, and as I was coming back, the other band kind of fell apart, and he hit me up. He's like, hey, I want to start a project. I know you're coming back. Let's do this. So that's kind of like how this band got started. We've been together since... in this capacity since last September. And then altogether, the band has been around since late March, early April of last year.
So the Eldritch Grimoire, when I say the name and think of the wordage, I kind of imagine like a nightmarish fairy tale.
The story of the name is really interesting. When we were trying to come up with a name, Justin was like adamant on, I don't want to just pick a random... because the band before, which will not be named, had a really dumb name. So he's like, I don't want another dumb name. I don't want another stupid, like, I don't want to just pick the first thing we think of and go. I really want to put thought into this. And I threw, like, 500 names at him, and he hated them all.
What was the worst?
The worst? I don't even remember half of them. Like,
what was the second worst?
I think, as far as I remember, the worst name I threw at him, which even to this day, like, even when I pitched it to him, I'm like, I hope he doesn't say yes to this, because this is an awful fucking name. I believe it was something along the lines of like At Perdition's Pass or something like that.
Perdition's Pass.
Like nobody's gonna know it.
That's an indie rock band.
Yeah, I mean it sounded awful, and I'm like, this is awful. We're not calling ourselves this. Never mind, forget I said anything. But our old bass player Tommy was like, hey, I want our name to have some kind of like, you know, some kind of like reference to like literature and like nerd culture and stuff like that. And I'm like, okay, let me think. And I'm a huge fan of like H.P. Lovecraft's work. And so I didn't want to pick anything to do with, like, Cthulhu or anything, because that's kind of drawn out and boring. And I was reading up on some stuff, and I came across something about the Necronomicon, and it was referred to as an Eldritch Grimoire. And I'm like, that's really fucking cool. So I sent it to Justin, and Justin didn't like the name. He's like, I don't know, dude. That's going to be a hard name to pronounce. A lot of people are going to have a hard time with it. Like, I don't think that's the right name to pick for us. The funny thing about that is our very first show ever, our name was spelt incorrectly on the flyer. We were the Eldritch Gilmore.
Gilmore like Gilmore Girls?
Yeah.
Gilmore Boys?
Our band chat name for a long time was the Eldritch Gilmore Girls because of it. It was kind of
you should have gone with Gilmore Boys.
The Gilmore Boys.
I tried to get him to Photoshop our faces onto the characters of the Gilmore Girls. He never did it, though.
You sure?
If I had time, I would have. At the time, I was working like 80 hours a week, and I really didn't have time to do that. So.
You could still do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's never too late. Now that we're talking about it now, maybe I'll just throw it up on our band page.
That should be a limited edition run shirt.
We can't even afford the shirts we have now. But so I sent the idea to Justin, and he didn't really like it all that much. Tommy, our old bass player, loved it, but Justin really didn't like it all that much. And I'm like, I know I can sell this name to him because I love this name. So I hit up my buddy. His name's Jake. He runs a design company called Interloper Designs. And I said, hey, I really like your work. Can you throw together a logo for me? I paid out of my own pocket for this logo. And he was just getting started, so it was like dirt cheap. And he did a great job on it. It's our current logo now. And I'm like, I know if this logo looks cool, I can sell it. So he sends me the logo. It looks amazing. I send it to Justin, and he goes, wow, that looks really fucking cool. Okay, I'm down with this name. This looks awesome. And that's kind of like where the name came from. And we do constantly correct people that spell it incorrectly. Rich is used to that with Opusaya.
Opusaya.
But I've been friends with Will for like 7 years. And so when he like posted, hey, here's my new band, the Eldritch Grimoire, I almost said it wrong myself. But I saw the name and the artwork. I'm like, that's badass. I wish I was in a band. And then I kind of weaseled my way in.
There's
that
like
the logo?
There's like horses in it, right? Or something that kind of looks like horses, like there's a horse carriage thing.
There's
horses.
Tentacles at the bottom.
Tentacle. I'm stupid.
It's okay. There's tentacles at the bottom, and then inside the O on Grimoire is the symbol of the Necronomicon.
Okay.
Which
I'm dumb.
Which I had to fight for because the other two guys, because there was only three of us at the time, the other two guys didn't want the symbol in it, and I'm like, no, the symbol's staying. Like. And now it's like one of my favorite parts.
He just decided.
Like, I already paid for this, so I'm not changing it.
Yeah.
That's pretty much what I told him. I'm like, this has already been paid for. This is the logo we're going with. If you guys want to go with this name, this is what we're using. And since then, I want to do more work with Jake. I really want to do like a revamp of our logo because he's gotten a lot better. I'm gonna name drop him again. Interloper Designs. I can't recommend him enough to any upstarting artists who are looking for a good logo for a good price. He's amazing.
I'm so glad that you remember to breathe when you're telling stories because you really talk fast and I'm trying to have it all sink in and I'm like, wait, what? I'm trying not to miss anything.
Yeah,
he's a professional.
That's a problem that I have.
Will has theater experience.
Yeah.
So he
nice.
I've learned how to. Well, I have theater experience, and I grew up with three siblings, so I had to learn to talk fast if I wanted to be heard.
There you go. Well, let's before we get into more background about the band, let's play an Eldritch Grimoire track and introduce our listeners to the band. So, what is the first track that you want to play tonight?
The Semblance.
Semblance of Sincerity. It's Sincerity, Luco, not Serenity.
That's probably
Morgan.
My bad. I'm sorry. I'm an
That's
idiot.
My favorite song.
That's the first song we wrote when Steve joined. Yeah.
It's one of our favorite songs collectively. It's
That we
have released so far.
I wrote the majority of the song when I was like 16. So
brag about it, Steve.
Yeah, I will brag about
it. Oh, you're going to hear him humble brag a lot.
I am great.
That's why you're lead guitarist.
Humble brag.
Damn
you're
straight.
Hear him humble brag a lot.
Hard facts.
All right, here we go. Eldritch Grimoire. We'll be right back. What's going on? I'm Morgan Danielle.
I'm Luco Blaze from the Metal Experience in Chicago, Illinois.
And you're listening to a Small Town Mentality podcast with your hosts, Ben and Austin.
You're listening to the Metal Experience.
We've assembled a collection of bands who have drummers.
I do magic.
Well, it's easy if you try, Dick.
Now sit back and listen.
Woo! All right. That was a Semblance of Sincerity by the Eldritch Grimoire. I can barely pronounce it.
Good.
I'll get it, though.
Let me tell you, it's going to get even worse with the new album.
Jesus Christ, you guys.
Jesus criminy. Well, we're rocking out here at the back of Fitz's Lanes. Will, why don't you go ahead and tell me what the that song was about?
So I've actually never, like, gone on record. Like, a lot of people know what the song's about, but I've never actually, like, publicly talked about this song. It's very, very special to me because this song is kind of like, it tells a story in three parts. The first verse is from my perspective. So before I get into that, I guess I should, like, explain what the song's about. It's about, like, realizing that somebody that you're really close to or somebody that, you know, you care about just doesn't give a shit about you. And, like, you're
kind of feeling.
You're kind of like, well, the song is about an old friend of mine from years ago. We were, like, best friends in high school and whatnot. And we kind of grew apart. We grew back together. And at one point, she was, like, my closest confidant. I was in, like, a really rough time of my life. And I instilled some stuff in her that that was, like, very, like, personal to me, and she used it against me to
the fuck?
Like, so, like,
who is she?
To not sound like an emo, to not sound like a little emo boy, I had a short bout with suicidal tendencies when I was 21 years old.
I love that band.
And I had told her that this was when the old band that I was talking about that I started with Justin, that was when we were starting, and I had told her, like, the only thing that's really keeping me going right now is playing music. And we were practicing in my apartment that I shared with her and a couple other friends. And one of the guys that lived there was also our landlord. And the day after I told her that literally, like, the only thing keeping me alive is playing music, my landlord comes to me and tells me that she complained about my band playing there and we couldn't practice there anymore. And that to me was, like, that first, like, telling moment of, like, this person really doesn't give a shit about me. We've been friends for, like, 8 years and she just doesn't fucking care. And so the song tells the story in three parts. The first verse is from my perspective, and it's, like, me, like, kind of, like, trying to remind her that, like, there were good moments in our friendship, and I wanted her to, like, remember that stuff. It harkens back to one of my favorite memories with her, where we were laying out in on a field in a park down the road from her house, and it was, like, 10 o'clock at night. Bright sky, stars out everywhere, and we were just talking about life and shit like that. So that's what the first verse is. The second verse is from her perspective, or, like, what I would assume her perspective. Thanks, Steve.
He's pouring his heart
I'm
out.
I'm pouring
here.
My heart out on the Metal Experience, and you're gonna burp into the fucking microphone. God, I hate.
He waited
you.
10 months for this interview, Steve.
So.
He waited 10 months, Steve. You fucking dick.
One burp ruined it all.
Now we're putting a second chain on you at the practice space. So the second verse is what I assume
that's
would be from, like, from her perspective, or at least, like, my understanding of, like, how she felt, where she felt like I was, like, smothering her. Because at one point she did tell me, like, she needed space because she felt like I was smothering her, which I thought was kind of ridiculous because I was just, like, trying to hang out and be friends and shit. And so she's telling me that I'm smothering her. She doesn't want anything to do with me. And I'm like, okay, whatever. And I'm, like, beating myself up over it. And then the third verse is actually from a third-party perspective of somebody that was, like, close to me at the time. And her pretty much telling me, like, hey, this person's a piece of shit. You need to get away from her. And I'm just like, I don't listen. I'm not listening. And so the whole song is pretty much just, like, me coming to terms with the fact that, like, one of my best friends just isn't my best friend. And I had promised myself I'd never write a song about it. And then I went and did it. And actually, I love this song so much, I wrote a second part that may or may not be going on our next album. We'll see. But I wrote the lyrics, and I'm in love with the lyrics. So I'm really hoping I can convince them to let me write or go ahead and go on with part two.
Music is therapy, and it helps.
Well, I make the joke all the time that we're an emo pop punk band disguised as a death metal band.
It's really true. Like, I was literally talking to our drummer because our drummer bitches all the time because, like, he tries to be one of these hard ass fucking,
like, tough guy
death metal dudes, and he's like, why can't we just write songs about, like, stabbing people and killing people? And I'm just like, dude, what are we, Cannibal Corpse in the 1990s? Like, come on, man, we're writing shit about real life now.
Well, speaking of, you know, what he wants pointless, like, to sound like, what were some of your influences growing up? Like, how did you guys get into music?
You want to go first, Rich?
For me, thrash metal is what got me into metal. So Metallica, Anthrax, Slayer, not so much, but kind of. And then I got into more extreme stuff as time went on, and then I'll listen to pretty much any kind of metal now. And I can't really say that, like, one style or one band influenced me, because I'll listen to any kind of music, honestly, but I just had the most fun playing metal, so. Speeve.
All right. Speeve.
I'm really into 80s shred dudes. Like, I love Yngwie Malmsteen. I love Paul Gilbert, Marty Friedman, Vinnie Moore, Jason Becker, all that stuff. Randy Rhoads, Vivian Campbell. My two favorite bands are, like, Ozzy and Dio. I'm really into 80s shred.
You can definitely hear that in some of our songs, his 80s shred influence. One of the songs we'll play later, which is, like, I would say our most popular song, Tragedy.
Yeah.
You definitely hear it. I'll tell you a fun little story about his solo when we get to it, but there's a really cool story about his solo that's just I like telling, because I like, as much as Steve likes talking about himself, I also like talking about Steve, so.
I also like talking about Steve.
That's our common interest.
I do. I mean, like, I'm not
common
even
interest talking about Steve.
Speed.
As far as
his
me,
name is Speven.
Yeah, his name is Speven with a B, not a T.
Speven hard fast, but cacas. Shout out to Jake Farhang.
Who comes up with the most ridiculous nicknames for us. It's fucking ridiculous. I love that boy. As far as, like, so the funny thing about me is, like, I got into metal, as far as I'm concerned, like, really late in life. I didn't start listening to heavy metal until I was, like, 16, 17 years old. Like, a lot of the people that I know started when they were, like, 10. But I grew up around, like, punk music. My dad's played drums for 30-plus years, and he introduced me to a lot of the stuff that I know. And when I was in middle school, going into high school, I listened to, like, butt rock. Like, I listened, my favorite bands were, like, Breaking Benjamin, Theory of a Dead Man. My favorite band of all time for, like, 3 years was Nickelback. I'm not even going to front.
I'm not going to hate. I really like
Morgan
Nickelback.
Morgan loves Nickelback.
You know, I went through my phase where I'm like, yeah, no, fuck Nickelback. They suck. And now, like, I'm like, I will sit down and I will listen to All the Right Reasons and you cannot fucking stop me. Mm-hmm. But after that, like, what happened was I went through a really bad breakup my sophomore year, as most do. And my buddy at the time was like, hey, you know, I know you're going through a hard time. Listen to the CD. It might help you. And he hands me a copy of The Fall of Ideals by All That Remains.
Nice.
And that, I unlike Rich, where he says he can't really pinpoint one area, I can. It was listening to The Fall of Ideals by All That Remains that made me a metal fan. And then from The Fall of Ideals, ironically, I just jumped over everything and jumped right into, like, severe, like, brutal death metal. I started listening to, like, Devourment, Morbid Angel, Cannibal Corpse, stuff like that. And then I, like, progressed from there into, like, deathcore and listening to shit like Chelsea Grin, Suicide Silence, which I still like deathcore to this day. It's not my favorite genre anymore, but I kind of jumped all around metal. And then recently, over the last few years, I tell people all the time I'm a poser parading as a metal artist, because I actually don't really listen to all that much heavy metal anymore. Like, Carnifex is my favorite band, and they dropped an album this year, and I listened to that. And there are a bunch of albums that were dropped this year. This was a great year for music.
It has been.
This has been a great year for music, and there's a lot of metal albums that have dropped this year that I've listened to. But, like, for everyday listening, like, if I'm just, like, cleaning my house, I'm listening to, like, pop punk, or I'm listening to, like, you know, fucking butt rock. Like, I've gone back to my roots a little bit. And, you know, my favorite band is a two-piece acoustic duo called This Wild Life. And they just announced that they're playing a show in California where they're playing my favorite album in entirety, and I'm trying to figure out how much a kidney goes for on the black market. Because I work at a hotel, so I can get, like, cheap rates on a hotel room. The hard part's going to be flying there. But I really don't want to miss this show, so I'm, like, really excited about that. But, yeah, I mean, as far as, like, influences to get me into heavy metal, it was definitely All That Remains. And then as far as like becoming a vocalist, I'm not going to lie, I've been doing vocals for almost 10 years now, but I didn't start getting really good at it until like, I don't
last
know.
Year.
Last year, maybe. Last year, he's right. Last year, maybe 2 years ago. I didn't take it seriously, and I actually, after I left the band I was in with Justin Pryor, I took a really long time off because I kind of like lost my love for it. After leaving the band, I was kind of like, man, this fucking sucks. I don't want to do this anymore. Being a musician fucking sucks. And I took almost a whole year off, which completely like ruined any progress I was making. And it wasn't until actually really that I started practicing for being in Eldritch that I really started getting better. And like you can hear it if you listen to, I wish we had the original recordings we made with Tommy. If you listen to those and then you listen to the stuff from the EP, you can hear like this huge difference, not just production wise, but like just in my voice. And
I mean, before I joined the band, they played a little show at our practice space with the old lineup before me and Steve joined. And from that point till when we played our first show last year in November, Will's vocals improved immensely in that short amount of time. And
yeah,
so
Will has gotten a lot better since I joined, I feel like.
What made you get into vocals rather than, you said your dad was a drummer? Did you ever try drums?
I've dabbled around in a little bit of everything. I've done drums, guitar. My very first band I was ever in was a female-fronted pop-punk band, and I was handed a bass guitar, didn't know how to play bass at all, and my buddy's just like, oh, it's okay, I'm going to teach you, because their bass player fucking sucked and always flaked out on them. So I was at practice more than he was, so they handed me a bass, and I played like 4 or 5 shows with them, and then our lead singer divaed out, and that band fizzled out. And then I was like, yeah, okay, I'm down to play bass, but I'm not going to lie, I just fucking suck at playing instruments. I've been playing guitar for like 8 years, and I'm just now getting down like basic chords. I can play acoustic guitar pretty all right. I tell people all the time, I can play guitar really well if you don't know how to play guitar. I can impress you if you don't know how guitar is played, but if you even know a little bit of guitar theory, you're going to see right through it. But vocals really was something, like, I was already a classically trained singer. I've been a chorus singer since I was in 5th grade, and then like Rich said earlier, I have theater experience, so you know, I've kind of been doing that for a while, and then as I got into heavy metal, I'm like, hey, I want to try this stuff, and I started screaming along to my favorite songs poorly, and just started kind of improving and getting better and better. And I think one of the things that's great about vocals is you don't need to like set anything up to practice. You can practice anywhere, on your way to work, in your car,
yelling at your cat
in your shower. I'm not going to lie, I do it at work sometimes when nobody's around.
While you're beating off?
Yeah, I mean...
Anywhere.
Anywhere. It's one of my favorite things about being a vocalist is I don't have to really like sit down and practice. I can just kind of practice wherever I need to go, and that's kind of why I'm improving so much, I feel.
Nice. Well, let's play another track. Let's play... what was the track that you were saying has that really sweet guitar solo?
Oh, yeah.
Tragedy.
The Tragedy.
Tragedy.
And yeah, it was the first song we released.
It was the first song we ever released. We released it as a single. And the fun story about this song is it's the first song. It was the first song we recorded in general. But we recorded with Jake Farhang of Aletheia. And we went in there and we recorded it in one weekend, which is pretty crazy to record a whole song from...
Hold on. Steve, I'm going to mute your microphone if you keep burping into it.
I'm sorry.
Like, I deliberately, like, I can see you every
doing.
Time you're burping.
He goes
then
right
you
for
move
it.
Forward just to do it into the microphone.
I thought it was spice thing.
He does that at practice, too. He'll walk up to my mic for backing vocals.
Oh, my gosh.
And just burp into it while we're playing a song.
He's used to it.
Yeah. I'm a jokester. So, I'm sorry.
So we're at practice, or we're at the studio, right? And we've just laid down drums. We've laid down... rhythm guitar,
bass.
And bass, and so Steve's like, okay, I'm gonna sit down and I'm gonna do. No, we don't. You hadn't done bass yet.
Yeah,
you
no,
went
I
to
did.
Subway.
No, because when I came back,
no,
I left to go get food.
Oh yeah, that's right, that's right, that's right.
Yeah, you
I
went
left
to
go.
Subway.
I left to go get food. I went to get food at Subway, which was like 8 minutes away. So it was an 8 minute drive, like maybe 4 minutes to get my food, because there was nobody there. So they ran me through real quick and got me out. Another 8 minutes back. So 20 minutes, I'm gone. I come back and Rich is sitting down. I'm like, okay, did they decide to do bass instead? And Jake's just like, Steve one-taked everything. I'm like,
whoa.
What do you mean Steve one-taked everything? He's like, he sat down and he just fucking ripped it out. And he's like, okay, I'm done. I'm like, okay, let me hear it. So he plays the solo from this song. And Steve made this solo up. No preparation. He didn't write the solo.
No, he had some preparation.
A little bit.
A little bit of well,
the end of it was improvised.
Yeah, the ending of the solo was improvised, but it was completely improvised. He did it in one take, one shot, and that right there was just incredible to me because I've never heard of a musician sitting down and kicking out a solo in 20 minutes.
I was really nervous.
Well,
too,
not even. It was more like he sat down, he ran, like just he did some licks to warm up, and so maybe took him like 10 minutes to whip that solo out.
Yeah, it was incredible, and to this day. Tragedy is another one where I'll tell you the backstory when we get back, because that one's got a really, really, like, dark backstory, and it's a very, it's another very personal one, but it's definitely our most popular song, I feel, because it's, A, it's been out the longest, and B, it's just, like, because of the feeling of it and what it's about, people tend to gravitate towards it, so it's one of our favorites, too. It's another one of our favorites.
Before we play the tragedy, Steve, one more burp.
No, oh, I can't no, anymore. Because I have a question for him. I don't want burps. I want answers.
I will answer the question.
Damn it.
I'm sorry for the burping.
I want to know.
That's hilarious.
So if you did an improvised solo in that short amount of time with like a little bit of preparation, not much, how do you remember what you played to play it again live or later on?
I just hear it and I just like.
And you can remember how you played it?
Yeah, basically.
The kid's got an eidetic memory when it comes to riffs and licks and solos it's, and shit.
He's got a really good ear.
Yeah. Like, it's almost better. I like to get in like the groove of the music.
Like when he came in to audition, like he came, like we had demos for God Hand and Scarlet.
We had demos for God Hand and Scarlet. We didn't, we still to this day have not tabbed out any of our music because we're trash.
We tried once, then we realized, oh, this is a lot of work. We don't want to do this.
Yeah. So, well, that and, you know, Steve doesn't know how to tab, so he knows how to read tabs, but he doesn't know how to tab out stuff himself. So when he came into audition, I literally had just sent him this, like, raw.
He had maybe, like,
like
half a week to prepare. And,
like, three or four days, and I sent him this raw guitar track with no, like, and
no drums.
It was pretty awfully recorded, too, because it was recorded at my apartment. Through like a line six like spider, and our other guitar player
put it on insane mode.
Yeah, exactly.
Like it sounded.
But Steve came in and he knew those. Like I was only in the band for like a week at that point, and I was still learning the stuff. And he came in and knew two songs right off the bat, and I'm like, okay.
Yeah, when I joined the band, I already like ear learned like all their stuff from like shitty little recordings they gave to me.
Yeah, after we play Tragedy, I can tell the story, and then I'll kind of go into like because I didn't really like break down like how these two ended up with us.
Not a problem. All right, here is the tragedy from the Eldritch Grimoire. God damn it, you guys, and burps.
Just burping.
Oh, Well, hi there.
Hello. We know you're enjoying your current dose of metal with the people at the Metal Experience. What are their names, Ryan?
Hey, Morgan and Luco, how you doing?
Well, howdy. Should you get through with your dosage with them and find yourself still wanting metal, come see us at the Epitome of Stupidity podcast. You can find us on Podbean, Spotify, Google Play, iTunes, and other places, I'm sure.
Yeah, and it's cool. It's a cool show, I must say.
Until then, back to these guys.
Bye-bye.
Meredith.
I'm Ryan.
And I'm John. And we are Victims. And you're listening to The Metal Experience. Check out our full-length album, Volume 2, Inside the Mind, available everywhere. Yep.
All right, we're back. I'm Morgan Daniel with Luco Blaze, hanging out here with the Eldritch Grimoire tonight. And that was the song, The Tragedy. Dun, dun, dun. And you wanted to tell us a little bit about what it's about. So
yeah, so The Tragedy is a song that I don't want to say we were commissioned to write because that sounds stupid because we weren't paid for it. But a couple of years ago, I had a friend who lost her son to a murder-suicide.
Oh, jeez.
Her ex-husband, he was 5 years old, and her ex-husband locked her out of a room, barricaded it shut, shot their son in the head, and then killed himself. And she came to me and she's like, I want your band to write a song about this. I feel like this is a story that needs to be told. And I'm like, absolutely. If you want us, if you're okay with it, I'm cool with writing that. And when we talk about this song, it's definitely the one that hits people the hardest because it's like it's raw material. It's very much like it's not a story that I just wrote. It's a real thing that happened.
That's
thing is, it's like such dark material, but it's also like we think it's our one of the most fun songs we have to play,
which kind of sucks because like when we're practicing we like have fun with it, we do stupid shit, and I feel bad because it's like this song is so like it's supposed to be like deep and dark and stuff, and Rich and I are just sitting there flossing during like the pre-breakdown. Like it's stupid.
He pantses me like two times
when he's soloing. I'll go up and I'll pants him or something.
Like, we just, because we've been playing it for so long and we know the song like the back of our head, because that song was written before these two even joined the band.
Yeah. I just added the solo.
Yeah, he just added the solo. So, we've been playing this song for over a year now. So, I mean, like, it's to the point where we can play it like the back of our hand. We can go 3 months without playing it and then just pick it right back up like we never stopped playing it. So.
How long ago did this happen?
I want to say it was. I'm going to feel bad if I get it wrong. I want to say it was like late 2017 it happened. It was before I moved back to Illinois, but not long before I moved back to Illinois.
So when she approached you to do a song about this tragic event, how did she want you to portray the event? Like, did she give you a feel for how she wanted it
she
to be
just,
told?
Not really. She just kind of was like, this is the story. This is what I want everybody to hear. So I took the story and I told it the way she wanted to. I made it out exactly the way I wanted it to, where, you know, we portrayed her ex-husband as a vile, disgusting person, because he was. And, you know, the whole song is kind of about how, you know, despite the fact that he's gone, he still lives on in the memory of people that knew him and through her. She was actually at our first show, the one that we did before Rich joined. That was like her first time hearing it ever, because that was before we had ever recorded it, and she said we did exactly what she wanted. So I'm really really proud of that song for a lot of reasons, but the big one is, you know, I was able to help a friend. Like, this was kind of a way to help her like cope with the loss of her son. So, you know, it was really cool for her to come, and you know, her and I, we were kind of close, but we're not like super close. So she could have gone to anybody and asked them to do this, and so it felt like really special to me that she came to me and asked me to do it.
Yeah. Wow. Never have we heard a story like that. I have. Whew. Don't know what to say after that.
I'm making this really hard because all my songs like hit hard, and then we're going to listen to one of our songs later, which is just about getting the bubonic plague. So, like, that'll be easy.
Well, no, the other two songs that we have left that to play are just one's about the bubonic plague and one's about anime. So.
Total left turn there. So when you guys are together and you're writing music, how does your process usually work?
So here's how our process goes. I'll let Rich actually explain it, but I'm going to tell it this way first. Justin brings us a riff and says, this is what we want to play. And we go, no, Justin, that's fucking stupid. and then we give it to Steve, and Steve actually writes the riffs. No, that's not true.
So usually what it is, well, there's two ways we write songs. It's Steve writes amazing riffs, but he's not really good at piecing them together. So Steve will bring a bunch of riffs and throw them at us, and I'm really good at piecing riffs together into songs. So we'll sit there and maybe take a practice to just piece it together, structure it out how we want it to be, and then we'll fill in what needs to be filled in, like transitions and stuff.
That's where Justin comes in. He's really strong on like figuring out transitions. He's good with like harmonies and making the guitars really pop and stick out. And then Chance, as far as like drums go, Chance can take a riff, he can hear it one time, and he'll have the drum pattern he's picked out already. Like it's pretty crazy. He kind of talks down on himself because he's not a sloppy drummer, but he's not been drumming as long as like a lot of these.
He's only been drumming for like 3 years.
Yeah, so he's not been drumming as much as like a lot of these bands, local bands. But like the kid has an ear for just like picking things up and going with them. And he does this thing where he writes above his like ability level to make himself work harder and be able to play those parts. And it works because he's improved so much since he started playing with us.
And then the other way we write music is Justin is more so better at just writing a whole song by himself. So Justin will just like, hey, I'm writing a song. And then a month or two later, he'll be like, oh, here's a song I wrote. He'll play it for us. We'll learn it. We'll run through it. And we'll take out stuff we don't think is needed, add stuff that we think is needed. And then Will has a plethora of lyrics.
I literally have all the lyrics for our full length next year already written.
And then he'll just see which ones fit the song the best, or if he has one, he's like, I really want this song to be this way. So we kind of structured the lyrics, and then we fit the riffs into where the lyrics worked. And I don't know, it's. I like the way we write.
It's like a whole group process.
Yeah, it's
like I throw riffs at him, and we all like structure it together. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's not just one person writing, which is important to me because like I've been in bands like that where it's one guy writing all the music, and it's like you don't feel like you've contributed anything.
But I'll literally like when we're writing, I'll sit like we have a whiteboard in our practice space. I'll sit there with it in my lap and be structuring. Okay, we're gonna play this riff for like four bars, then we'll transition to this riff, then we'll go back to this and.
And while he's doing that, I'm going through my lyrics on my phone, trying like following along. I'll have Steve and Justin play the guitar riffs after we structured the song. I'll have them play the guitar riffs and have Chance play his drums for like three or four times. And I'll go through and I'll read different lyrics and see what until I find one that fits best. And my thing is like I write the lyrics in advance, but I'm not stuck to my structures. So if I need to change things, and I often do, I will. Pretty much, I don't like waiting to write my lyrics because when the inspiration hits me to write, I want to write. I don't want to be like, oh, we don't have this song written yet, so I'm going to wait. Because who knows if that inspiration is going to be there, you know, 4 months from now when we write the song.
And what was it? I was going to say something.
Remember.
Remember.
Maybe burp to make him remember.
It didn't come out. But no, I feel like also like it might sound like a long process, but when we sit down to focus on writing songs, we'll literally like write an entire song in a practice.
In a 5-6 hour practice.
And then we'll come back the next week and we'll run through it and
we'll touch it up a little.
We'll touch it up and either we realize, okay, we like it, we'll keep going with this, or we'll be like, nah, this is a shit show. We're scrapping this one.
Yeah,
we just did that recently.
We just did that recently. We just wrote a song and we had it all structured out and everything and then for reasons outside of our control, we couldn't practice for a couple of weeks, and we came back and we're like, we don't remember how this song is played.
Well, we might come back, but
we might come back to it because we still know some of the riffs. But we tried to play it again, and just like, did we really write this way? It's just like it's not really working. And I feel like what we're planning to do after our last show, Armageddon Fest, November 2nd, is we're gonna sit down. Well, we're gonna hit the studio in December to record two singles.
Yes.
Songs we've already written.
Yeah, we are really excited to do this.
And we're gonna be working with Joe Tiberi. You two know him.
Dang. Whoa.
Yeah. But I feel like once we're done with that, we're just gonna sit down and write. We're probably gonna pump 7 or 8 songs out in a few months' time.
That's what we're hoping, anyways.
Yeah.
We wanna hit the. So we're planning to write a full length album next year, or record a full length album at the end of the year next year. We wanted to actually skip over doing an EP entirely and go right to writing a full length, but we felt that was going to take too long to get music out, and like we were already kind of like hitting the ground running, so we wanted to keep that momentum going. So that's why we ended up releasing Prologue, and then the full length album. We're looking at probably like 8 or 9 songs. We've got 2 written already, and then we're probably going to knock out the other 6 or 7 while we're on our little break.
Then we're doing those 2 singles because we don't want to go and like that long without releasing music.
We don't want to lose track of where we're at.
It's just
right
in
now.
In the modern industry, I guess you could say we're not really part of the industry, but if you want to stay relevant, you need to constantly be releasing music. You can't go
months without releasing stuff.
Like a year without releasing.
You know, it'd be
stuff.
One thing if we were Metallica or like one of these huge bands, you know, not even that big, you know. There are bands like Cannibal Corpse. They can go 2 years, 3 years without releasing music, and as soon as they release a new album, everybody's jazzed on it. But we're a shitty local band, you know. We go 6 months without releasing an album. Nobody gives a fuck about us anymore. There's 4,000 other local bands that have released better songs than we did, so. You know, and that's why we don't really like to compare ourselves to other bands. Like, I know a lot of people look at, like, especially local music is kind of a cutthroat business because there's this many.
Well, there's only so many shows. And
there's only so many shows and so many venues. And for every show and venue, there's 45 bands trying to get on that show and venue. So it kind of does become a bit cutthroat. And we don't really look at it that way. You know, we take the shows that we can get and we have fun and we play venues we like to play and we play with bands we like to play with. And you know, we're not really in this to, like, you know, build a career out of it. You know, Rich and Chance, they both have big boy jobs. Steve pretty much has a big boy job. I work at a hotel, so I'm in a dead end job, but at least I'm happy.
Justin delivers
pizzas. So, you know, but
slang and Zaz, brass, slang and Zaz.
You know, it's funny. Speaking of delivering pizzas, a funny story about musicians delivering pizzas. I used to live in Florida. I was in Florida for 3 years.
Yes, we know Will.
I don't remember if I'd brought it up on air. I couldn't remember if I'd said that because it's going to be weird if I'm like, hey, when I was in Florida, and people are like, what the fuck? When was, what is this? Why is he bringing this up? When I was living in Florida, I would order pizza from this local place, and one day I'm sitting there, I'm wearing a Chelsea Grin t-shirt, watching TV, and I get the doorbell, and I'm like, oh, hey, here's my pizza. And I open up the door, and the guy hands me the pizza, and he's like, he looks at my shirt, he's like, oh, hey, is that a metal band? I'm like, yeah, they're a metal band, they're a deathcore band. He's like, oh, that's cool. I'm Steve Swanson from 6 Feet Under. I'm like, what the fuck? And I'm like, no, you're not. Why is Steve Swanson delivering pizzas to me? So I go and look, and sure as shit, it's him. And
that's crazy.
Yeah, so I don't really give Justin a lot of shit for doing pizzas because obviously it works for a musician like Steve Swanson. So
then when you went to visit your parents earlier this year, he was sitting on the couch with your dad having beers.
I wasn't visiting. My mom texted me. She's like, guess who's sitting on our couch having a beer with us? I'm like, who? She's like, Steve Swanson from 6 Feet Under. I'm like, well, fuck you then.
How did he end up at your house?
Well, he, like I said, he delivered pizzas out that way, and my parents are musicians as well. They're in a cover band down in Florida called Chronic State, and when he delivered, my parents, who are a little bit older,
you mean NASA astronaut Steve Swanson.
I didn't know that. That's man can do anything. No, he delivered a pizza to them at one point, and my mom happened to ask him. She's like, hey, you're that guy from 6 Feet Under, right? And he's like, yeah. So she gives him one of their CDs, and they didn't think anything of it. They figured he'd just toss it out his window. And he came back and delivered a pizza to them like a week later, and he's like, here, he was like, I love your guys' stuff. It's really good. And so that's a pretty cool tout that Steve Swanson liked my parents' music. And then, of course, my mother, being the wonderful mother that she is, shared our music with him. So now he's got a copy of our EP as well.
Hopefully.
That's pretty sweet. That's pretty sweet.
Mm-hmm.
Way to go, Mom and Dad.
I was looking at pictures of Steve Swanson.
My parents are very supportive, despite the fact that I know they would never say it, but they kind of wish I was playing a style of music that actually made money, because they want to retire and they want me to help them retire.
Well, my mom says all the time, why don't I just start a country band?
Oh, my mom used to tell me before I got into heavy metal that I should start like looking into like becoming a country singer, and I'm like, even before I got into metal, I'm like, no, I'm not gonna do that, Mom.
Let's write a country EP to play Country Thunder next year.
Turn into Danny Worsnop from Asking Alexandria.
Oh, Jesus.
We're no. Not concentrating on our metal band. We're
hey,
too busy working
hey, Nurgle
on Nurgle
from Behemoth did a country album, too.
So you can do it. I believe in you.
I mean, you could. You could.
But
now,
don't.
What would be your guilty pleasure band that you guys wouldn't normally admit to liking?
Will, that you wouldn't normally admit
See,
to like.
That's a hard thing for me because I don't really have any guilty pleasures. Like, I unapologetically listen to what I like. I can't really like, I mean, I guess, like, as far as, like, maybe not, like, guilty pleasure, but just kind of embarrassing, I fucking love LazyTown, the TV show. And the music in it is fucking fire. I don't give a fuck what anybody says. I have one of their albums, I have the LazyTown album at home, and I spin that shit pretty regularly. So as far as, like, I guess is a guilty pleasure, like, but, like, I listen to everything from fucking slam to fucking death metal to country to fucking pop punk to pop music. I really don't know. If I like something, I like it.
I'm the same way, but I guess for an artist no one would think that I'm really into. I fucking love Amy Winehouse. I think she had one of the best voices of the last 3 decades.
I didn't
she just like
it.
Cocaine.
Did you watch that documentary about her?
No, I haven't. I've been
it's
meaning
to, It's
a very
good documentary. You should really
but
watch
I loved her lyrics. I loved her voice. And it's tragic that she passed when she did, because I feel like she could have wrote some more amazing music.
Jamie loves her.
I'll answer for...
Yeah,
I'll
we don't need to hear more about your girlfriend, Steve. I'm already watching you blow kisses into your phone.
Blow burb kisses.
You will love to hear that.
I'll answer for Speeb. His favorite band is Metro Station.
No, it's not right. All right, my guilty pleasure is Blink 182. Because maybe I don't think a lot of people know that, but I love Blink 182, like the early stuff. But I also love maybe something that people don't know a lot about is I love classical music. Like people just playing like classical music on classical guitar, like anything with like interesting guitar. I love.
He listens to a lot of like I don't know if you listen to it, but you talk about it a lot, like flamenco guitar and like Spanish guitar and shit.
Yeah, I love like Paco. I don't know, Paco de Lucia? I don't know how to pronounce his last name, but I love anything like that. Like, classical guitar is really interesting.
Pretty much if it's somebody squeedly-wheedling on a guitar, it doesn't matter if it's acoustic or electric, Steve's down with it.
Yeah. Speeded. Classical guitar is really beautiful, and it's really shreddy at the same time, and that's why I like it. Because it's not just, like, a bee buzzing around, like, yeah.
So you like Rodrigo Gabriella?
Yeah, I love, it's like really beautiful, but there's a lot going on. It's really hard to play. I like stuff like that.
Morgan, you're so cool.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I want to fight you.
I agree.
I want to fight you.
That has nothing to do with anything.
That's it. After this, we're fighting.
Let's get ready.
I got $50 on Morgan right now.
Ooh, look at this.
Come over, watch the wrestling match.
I feel real bad.
Don't get us started on wrestling.
Money.
No, yeah, I'm not. I screwed up.
Steve is
I
the one saying
up.
Don't bring up wrestling, and then he's the one that brings it up.
For,
all right.
For reference or context, 90% of the stuff me and Will talk about is wrestling. Because
it's the only thing we have in common.
And then the rest of the brand just cringes
like,
the whole time.
Literally, we'll be sitting there at practice, and out of nowhere, we'll just start talking about wrestling, and like you could just see on everyone else's faces, they're like, oh, my God. Like,
not this shit again.
Like, Justin and Steve will sit down for a cigarette, and Chance will go lay down in the other room until,
like,
we're done talking.
It's like, are they done talking about that already? Because, like, we don't want to be a part of that.
But we won't delve into it on the Metal Experience, I promise.
Yes, we will not do this.
Epic.
It's Beben.
Legendary.
You guys have a couple shows coming up. I really quickly wanted to plug first. And we can do it again later, too, of course. But I wanted to talk about your upcoming events that people can catch you guys at.
The Crusaders show?
So
this Saturday.
Yeah, this Saturday out at 18th Street Brewery in Hammond, Indiana.
Luca, calm down.
We'll be there.
Our good friends in Crusaders are releasing a beer. And like Luke from Crusadus. He's in Opatia with me, so me and him are butt buddies.
Lukey?
Do you really want to admit that?
Yes.
Yes,
he does.
I mean, Cheyenne gets jealous of us, so.
Luke is a great guitarist.
But no, this, Luke's my best friend, so. So he just asked us to play, and just like, well, of course. And
I
so
have beer.
We're playing that one with
could you imagine being
Crusadus,
a local band?
Crusadus,
Dysphoria,
and what's the other
Hellgrind.
Name? Hellgrind. Yeah, I know there was like a change up. That's why I couldn't remember Hellgrind's name, because there was another band that was supposed to play, but fuck them, they're not playing anymore.
But fuck
whoa.
Them.
Whoa.
I don't even know who I don't. I can't even
he doesn't
remember
the band. Who they were.
I don't remember who they were. I'm sure they're wonderful people and they dropped for a good reason, but.
But fuck them.
But fuck them.
But yeah, it's gonna be a really good time. We're gonna drink some Crusadus beer. Well, everyone except for Will. And then we're
and
gonna
chance because he has to drive.
It's gonna be a really fun.
You really
time.
Think that's
can't
gonna
wait.
Stop him? The dude. I'm yeah, never mind. True. I'm not gonna air out Chance's dirty laundry. His mom's gonna listen to this.
I can't wait to talk about guitar players and stuff to Luke.
How mad do you think he'd be if I told his deep dark secret over the?
Oh, he would. He would literally kill you when he gets home from work tonight.
Come to Armageddon Fest November 2nd, and I'll tell you Chance's deep dark secret.
Oh my
and then
God.
That's the other show we're playing. That's actually gonna be our last show of the year. Is Armageddon Fest. And we share a practice space with Scars of Armageddon, and we're good friends with George. And
Jorge.
He just he was chilling out at practice one day. He's like, so yeah, you guys are going to be playing Armageddon Fest. He didn't even ask us.
He's like, oh yeah, you guys are going to be headlining downstairs. We're like,
okay.
Okay.
I haven't played the basement of Penny Road Pub since I was like 16.
In all the time I've been in music, I have never played the basement of Penny Road Pub. I've played Penny Road Pub twice, and both times I was upstairs.
I've never played the upstairs of Penny Road Pub. I've only played the basement.
That's what I hear from a lot of people. And our first show ever with this lineup was at Penny Road Pub upstairs.
That was the first time for me.
On the roof?
No, not on the roof. I think there's only been one show on the roof.
That was,
Luca was there to witness it.
That was Synovial's
show. He forgot
about
me. You saw Synovial without me?
I don't know.
I remember you telling this story on Synovial's Synovial's version of the podcast.
Luca.
I remember
fuck
this.
Yes,
they are good friends
of
ours.
Great time.
So if you were at that show, you actually saw Justin's old band.
Oh my God!
What was Justin's old band?
I can't say the name on air.
We're not gonna say it.
We don't want to be associated with them.
They were the band that played before Synovial, and they were probably not very well seasoned because they had two new musicians with them. I'm not gonna say they were bad because I don't know one way or another, but I do know that was like one of their first shows with the new guitar player and the new vocalist. So
very cringe.
After we start playing the next song, I'll go ahead and tell you off air what the band's name is.
Well, Luco, then it's about that time.
Is it?
It is.
It is.
See, Steve knows.
I know.
Steven.
Now it's time for...
Hey, man, look what I found!
Only on the Metal Experience.
Bukkake. All right. This week and every week is always brought to you by our friends at Imprint Recordings. Your music, your imprint.
Really?
Visit imprintrecordings.com for more information for all your recording needs. This week we have the band Misery Falls from Rochester, New York with the song Eternal. Let's fucking do it!
You think that you can save her? I'd like to see you try. Nobody's getting out of bed. Your soul will not be mine. This place shall be your grave.
Forever you shall die.
Nothing left to say.
The lies I'm going to claim.
The Dark Eternal. The Dark Eternal.
long, but now all things will then let go.
How dare you try to deny the fate I've chosen for you? How dare you try to defy me in my own? What is it about you that I just cannot seem to overcome? It all comes down to this here at the gate with no.
Hey everybody, this is Endostalgia at the Metal Experience, and our music will make you shit your pants.
That segment's brought to you by our friends at Imprint Recordings. Your music, your imprint. Visit imprintrecordings.com for more information for all your recording needs. And again, that was Misery Falls with the track Eternal, and they're from Rochester, New York. Give them a like on the Facebooks. Morgan?
Yeah.
Punch yourself in the face.
Nope.
She did it. The absolute madwoman.
Thanks a lot.
She's bleeding.
Thanks a lot for that.
So
that really hurt my feelings.
You punching yourself in the face?
I do it all the time.
Steven does it all the time.
Steven is admitting to a lot.
Steven has had too much to drink, like, and we're going to have to mute his mic soon because I know how he gets when he gets drunk.
Because apparently extra he drank burpee. Two like little airline bottles of vodka in the backseat of my car.
Nice. Little shooters?
So, little shooters, bruh?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
And then he's had three beers since he got here, and the kid's a lightweight, so
yeah,
I don't even drink, and I could probably outdrink Steven.
Well, you also weigh like four times as much as him.
This is fair.
140.
I weighed 140.
140.
Like
so I literally, dude, I'm literally almost three of you. Like,
Will's a big boy.
Why?
What do you weigh, Steven?
140.
I weighed 140 in third grade.
I weighed 140 coming out of the womb. My mother was a trooper.
At 24 years old.
You little, you son of a bitch.
All right, Morgan, do you have a question for us or something so we can get moving on to, like...
Yeah, let's get off of whatever you're...
Let's get on to Steven.
Okay.
Steven, what are you doing over there?
I wish we just had video.
Steve,
just
why don't
put
you...
on Steven this whole time to show just how weird he is.
I love it.
You know, it's funny because this is going to kind of segue into something I wanted to talk about.
Good.
When Steve joined the band, one of the things I asked was, like, because he's so good. He's such a good guitar player. One of the things I asked,
human
like,
being, terrible.
Like, like, he's such a good guitar player. When he came in to try out for us, I'm like, how the fuck has nobody scooped this kid up yet? Like, he's incredible.
Do you see why?
And now a year later, I'm like, on the way here, he threatened to, like, quit the band and join another band. I'm like, go ahead. Join any band you want, Steve. Within 2 months, you'll be back to us. Because nobody else is going to put up with
I
you.
I was joking. I didn't really
I, obviously
we
you
know you were joking.
But that kind of segues into what I was going to talk about. Like, I've been talking about how we've been a part of this lineup for
over a year now.
But I am the only person who's here tonight that is from like the very beginning of Eldritch Grimoire.
The OG.
Rich joined us last
September,
early September.
I kind of weaseled my way in.
Not really, because there was a lot of
For context, when Will was moving back to Illinois, he sent me a message on Facebook, like, Because me and we were never in a project together before, but he tried out for an old band of mine. And I always really wanted to work with him. The other guys in the band didn't think he'd fit.
They were right.
We were a thrash metal band, and he was doing like deathcore vocals, so yeah. It didn't really work. But I thought he was an amazing vocalist, and I wanted to work with him. And so I was actually going to message him to start a project, but that was right when he was moving to Florida. So it's like, oh, okay. And then before he moved back up here, he's like, hey, I'm moving back up at like the end of March, early April,
It was early April.
He's like, would you be I know you're busy with Opatia, but would you be interested in doing a side project with me and Justin? And be like, hell yeah, I've always wanted to work with you. And then they started Eldritch, and they brought the old bassist from their last band in. And
not for nothing against Tommy. Tommy, our old bassist, he's a wonderful guy. Great dude. Fucking, I love him. I cannot sing Tommy's praises enough. Not that I don't love Rich. He's a great guy. But Tommy, you think Steve's weird? You think Steve is fucking weird?
Well, you'd be having an hour and a half conversation about porn if Tommy.
Oh yeah,
was
he
here.
Would, and not just regular porn. This guy will go into like in depth about like the porn he watches from like the 1970s.
Nice dude.
And
Bush.
He's self-admitted porn connoisseur.
He is. He's a self-admitted porn connoisseur, and he talks about like. He'll tell a story, and he'll find a way to segue. Like, the story will start off like, so I was driving down a country road in my Lincoln Town and Country.
Yeah, Morgan, you never drove down roads in your Lincoln Town and Country?
And listening to Led Zeppelin.
That's exactly how he talks,
yeah,
by the way.
I'm not going to say it's a spot-on impression, but it's pretty fucking close.
The cadence of it.
I used to drive a Lincoln Town's car.
Shut up, Steve. Go smoke a cigarette or something. God, you're so annoying.
Don't go anywhere.
I won't.
Perfect. You know you want that nicotine, Steve. I could see it. You're licking your lips.
Well, it could wait.
He's licking the backs of his fingers.
But yeah, so Tommy was...
That sounded so terrible.
Tommy was a great guy, but he had a lot of stuff going on in his like personal life. And towards the end of August, beginning of... September, he's like he was talking about, you know, he's not really feeling it anymore, and we had come to a mutual agreement that we needed to move on without him because we were wanting to take it a little more seriously, and he wanted to keep it a little more like loose and aloof, and that's when, you know, I hit up Rich and I'm like, hey, are you still interested in being in this project? He's like, fuck yeah, absolutely.
Well, for context, when they did like their first show, when it was just like a little get together of close friends at their practice space, I came up to Will afterwards and be like, I know you're looking for a second guitarist, but if you guys want to move Tommy to guitar, I'll come in and play bass.
Because Tommy played guitar as well, and we were going to try that, but Tommy wasn't interested in putting that much of himself into it because of how busy he was, because being a guitar player, not that being a bass player is not important, but being a guitar player, you've got to deal with a lot more on surface level. When, you know, there's a lot more riffing involved and stuff like that. So he didn't want to put in that kind of like effort to it. So we didn't want to, we ended up just kind of going that way.
That's why I say I weaseled my way in.
He really didn't though, because like when we were talking about Tommy leaving, Rich was the first person I thought of. So that's kind of how we started. And we started playing together. At this point, Justin and I had been having conversations. Like, we weren't really happy with the way the music was going. And I was seriously considering quitting and telling them, like, I don't want to put time and effort and money into this shit if it's not gonna be the way we want it. Like, if we can't write the music we want to write, then what's the point? So, and about that time, I'm surfing Facebook. Like, we're still actively looking for another guitar player. Realistically, we were looking for a rhythm guitar player because Justin wanted to stay on leads, because Justin's not a bad guitar player. And I'm going through like one of those stupid Facebook groups, the, you know, Chicago local musician exchange help wanted.
That's right.
$40 blowjobs, you know. And he
that's
posts
selling knockoff Louis Vuitton purses.
Selling knockoff Louis Vuitton purses.
That's where I sold myself.
Steven was hanging out there.
Yes.
And so I'm just scrolling and I see this kid. He's like, oh hey, I'm looking for a band. You know,
the name Steven Hard B.
Yeah.
And I clicked the video and it's just him fucking shredding. And I'm like, holy fuck, this guy's really fucking good. So I hit him up and I'm like, hey man, are you looking? Are you, you obviously you're looking for a band? And he's like, yeah. First question he asks me is the question I always dread when I'm looking for musicians. Do you have any music to show me? Because at the time we didn't. All I had was like we were
those
talking
two
about
rough
early,
demos.
Those two rough demos that were only guitars and nothing else. So I'm like, I can send you this. This is what I've got. And I knew for sure if that's what I was going to send him, I wasn't going to be able to sell the band. So I was talking to him, and he's like, yeah, you know, this is kind of cool. I kind of like this. I'm like, well, would you want to come in and like jam with us and see if it's like something you'd be interested in? And he's like, yeah, sure, absolutely. So he comes in like the next weekend. That was like on a Tuesday. We practice on Sundays. So he came in on that Sunday. And he shows up in this like hatchback car, pulls this Marshall amp out of the back of his car.
That's
twice the size of him.
An angle head.
For the obviously, you know, people can't see. Steve's not a big guy. How tall are you, Steve?
I'm very weak and fragile.
He is very weak. He's afraid weak and fragile.
He kind of looks like Frodo.
Yes.
I thought he looked like Schmeagol.
Oh, yeah, Schmeagol.
Oh, yeah, I get that.
Who called you Schmeagol?
So a chick I was kind of seeing for a while, she said that while we were hanging out once. And then we were outside a Penny Road pub after a show, and the door guy turns around. He's like, hey, dude, that guy looks like Schmeagol.
Jeez.
Hey, which is funny. I don't see that, but what I do see is Michael Jackson, at least when he's got his face shaved.
I see a beautiful young man.
Me too.
I think there's some like romantic tension going on between Luco and Steve.
I don't know
here.
What's going on, but I want
I
it to stop.
It.
But so after Steve comes in and jams with us, we're like, he just blows all of us away, and we're like, dude, we almost don't want this guy to join the band because he's like, we're gonna hold him down. Like, he's way better than us.
Speak for yourself.
For me, it was like, you know, I came in and I saw like the kind of music they were playing, and that was the same kind of music I wanted to play. And I just thought I could add to it. You know, I could make it a lot better.
And I mean, when I say that Rich and Steve kind of breathe new life into the band, it's very true. You know, we wouldn't be the band we are. We wouldn't be a band at all, I think. At least not in the capacity that we're in now.
I don't think Chance would have stuck around if...
I don't think so. I really think we would have disbanded and gone our separate ways had you guys not joined the band. And now I couldn't imagine, like, not doing what we're doing. Like, we're making music that we actually like making.
We've played some awesome shows.
We've played some amazing shows. We got to open for one of my favorite bands earlier this year, Sea of Treachery.
Yeah. I've been having the most fun I've ever had. Mm-hmm. Like, really.
You know, being in a band, there's a lot of, it's very stressful, and there are nights where I just want to bang my head against the wall because being in a band.
I just do it when I want to.
Being in a band sucks sometimes because there's a bunch of bureaucratic bullshit
financial
you got to go through.
Financial
responsibility, you know. Like I said earlier, a couple of us have decent jobs, but the rest of us live paycheck to paycheck. And, you know, it's hard to come up with, you know, $250 to record. That's just one person alone, you know. It comes out to over $1,000. $250 a piece, and you're playing shows where you're not making dick for shit.
You're lucky to walk away with $30.
You're lucky to walk away with $30, and then we got to hand that over to Chance because he's the person that does all of our.
Because he's the only one we can fit all the instrument gear into his car, mm-hmm.
Most of the time we're walking away from shows losing money. But like I said earlier,
that's any local band. Even touring bands.
Yeah,
that's
pretty par for the course. If you want to make music and if you want to make money in music, you don't start a death metal band. But like I said earlier, we're not here to make money. We're playing this music because this is the kind of music we like to play, and we play the venues we like to play and play with the bands we like to play with. And, I'm not opposed to playing with anybody. You know, I'm done whether I like your music or not. If we're going to fit your bill and we're going to fit together and we're going to make an awesome show together, I'm down to play with anybody. But, that's the big thing is like, I'm not going to go and play with a pop punk band, despite how much I love pop punk, because we're not going to appeal to that.
I mean, we're going to quote unquote scare most of the people that are there for a pop punk show away.
Exactly. We've been invited to play a couple like cross genre shows, and I typically turn them down, not because I don't want to play them, but because we're a very aggressive metal band, and you know, we have those metalcore influences and, whatnot, but we still very much like I identify
well,
us
our,
as a,
our newer material that's not recorded yet is
definitely
it's heavier than the stuff we have recorded so far. So
And what the fuck are you doing?
I'm bonding with
you. We just need a Steve cam. Like, legit. Next time you bring him, just...
I'll bring my GoPro and I'll record it, then just send you the footage.
Like, I look over at Luco, and Luco's just, like, trying not to laugh. And then I just turn my head, and Steve's just, like, doing wizardry shit.
I just don't know what's happening. Like...
Yeah. This I love it.
I want to believe that this is one of the weirdest interviews you've ever done, simply because of Steve. I don't know how true that is, but I want to
hear
that.
Have you met Mike?
Fun fact, I met Mike once at a show, and I accidentally slammed into him and headbutted him in the chest. That was Well, Mike's a tall dude. Like,
I think what we need to do for next time
is bring Mike.
Well, no, we can have a dual interview with Opatia and Eldritch Grimoire.
That would be
and
cool.
And we'll see what will happen, because if you put Steve and Mike in the same
corner. Oh, my God. Let's just step away. Let's just let Steve and Mike come in and just fucking do their shit. Like,
okay,
you
I'm
might
down.
Just get weird comedy gold, or you could get a pure shit show. We'll find out.
Hard
find
grade.
Out.
I'm going to bring you to Mike's Halloween party next week, Steve, and see what happens.
But
these two could be best friends.
So, but that's the story kind of like how we kind of came together and the way we are now. And I feel like there's a lot of room for improvement. There always is. But we're at least happier with what we're doing. And like I said, the newer stuff we're writing is even heavier, even, you know.
Better.
I don't want to say better necessarily. I mean, it is better, but I feel bad saying that. Because
I'd say it's better in the sense that
we're more seasoned. We're
more seasoned, but we're more comfortable playing together now.
Yeah, we know how to work with each other.
So
exactly. I'm sure you do, Steve.
Yes.
It's Steven.
Steven.
We have learned how to write music with each other.
Exactly. We've learned how to write music with each
and
other.
And for context, for like the first 6 months Steve was in the band, he was like the most normal dude you could think of.
He got comfortable, and it was all over.
He did not act like this. Then he got comfortable after we recorded the EP, and he's just been a weird dude ever since.
I love it. Like
why do we let this guy in the band?
I honestly think he was afraid that we were going to kick him out at any moment.
If he acted this way, and it's like, we're not going to kick you out. Without you, this band would fail.
More lovable.
Like, I don't want to put too much on Steve's shoulders, but, like, you know, I think he writes,
like, 75% of the music at this point, and...
I have a whole piggy bank of riffs, and I'm just trying to cash it all in.
Yeah. I mean, I like that analogy. It's actually a pretty good analogy for you, Steve.
I got riffs for days.
Did you have to use all 8 of your brain cells for that one?
Oh,
yes.
Shots fired.
He's fried them all with fucking weed. So.
Yeah, poof.
This guy smokes a lot of weed.
Poof.
He was scraping his bowl at practice the other day to get the resin to smoke that.
That was desperate times.
Well, this sounds like a great transition here.
Yes.
Victims of the plague, because I feel like Steve was one of them.
So before we get started with Victims of the Plague, one thing I do want to say about it is this song was written kind of like, I don't want to say as a joke, but it was like, we kind of just started like fucking around. Yeah.
It was like the second song we wrote together.
Yeah, it was like the second song we wrote as a full band. And the song opens, you'll hear it when you play it, the song opens with these chants, and they're like gang chants. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, what death metal band does gang chants? Let's fucking do it. So
gang bang chants.
Black Dahlia Murder does.
Oh,
sometimes.
And for reference for gang chants, when we were in the studio...
He was so excited to tell us this part.
No, so when we were in the studio recording them, in between every word, Steve was giggling. So the gang chants for this song are Bring Out Your Dead. So bring out your dead.
Bring out your dead.
Bring out your dead.
Was Jake recording this?
Yes.
Yeah.
That
was he telling you shut the fuck up?
No,
Jake was laughing.
Jake thought it was the funniest shit in the
now,
world.
Now, was it Bring Out Your Dead based on Monty Python?
Yes and no. I mean,
Bring Out
Your
Dead.
That was an actual thing that the plague doctors and stuff would say during the bubonic plague.
And
boob.
The whole reason why I wrote this song is I did want to kind of...
Bubonic.
I wanted to kind
we
of...
We wrote this song because we wanted to put a plague doctor on a t-shirt.
I mean, not just that. That's a big part of it.
No, that's why.
We've yet to do that still, and we probably won't now because now it almost feels like it's too late. But I wanted to write like a more traditional death metal song because, again, most of the shit I write is, you know, kind of down to earth. So having a song that's just about people dying of the plague, you know, sounds death metal enough for me.
All right. Boom. Here is Victims of the Plague.
Bring out your dead. Hey yo, it's Troy Adams from the Podcast Wrestling Society. Every single Wrestling Wednesday, we bring you brand new episodes where we review the best and worst of professional wrestling eras of the past, as well as the biggest current events in professional wrestling and mixed martial arts. Search for us on YouTube, where we have hilarious WWE Network watch-alongs, reviews of terrible shows, and other great content. You can follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at PodRes Society, and we're available on all podcast platforms. Come join the Society.
This is Justin.
This is Dustin.
Austin's J&D.
Of the so-called Saints.
Or so-called Saints.
Tell your boys.
Or smell your boys.
You're listening to the Metal Experience.
Boom.
We are back with the Metal Experience. I am Morgan Danielle with Luco Blaze and the Eldritch Grimoire.
You're getting better at that. Every time you say it, you're getting a little bit better at pronouncing it.
Am I still saying it wrong?
No, you're still saying it. You're saying it correctly.
Oh.
The first time you and Luco said it, it was a little weird. But
the Eldritch Grimoire.
It
was a different kind of band name that I'd never heard before. I am huge at butchering the English language.
The burglar, 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 burglar.
So, you know how that goes.
You should see our band chat. Anytime Rich has to say something, I have to sit there and decipher it for 4 minutes because his fat thumbs just, like, don't work with his
button
board.
I don't read what I'm texting.
And he doesn't read, so fucking, Steve, I will break your fingers.
I listen to audiobooks.
I don't read.
There's nothing wrong with that.
But no, like, literally, I text too fast, and I don't proofread what I'm sending, so half of what I send is gibberish.
Yeah, so what we got to booster for, and then we got to get there by 6 p.m.
And then there'll be, like, 10 more texts of me just correcting every word I fucked up.
Your phone doesn't autocorrect at all?
It autocorrects the wrong words.
No, my problem is I hit B instead of space. So.
Gotcha. So what do you guys, I mean, besides the album coming up, what is your plan for the next year?
So a big thing, I mean, we're taking some time off to work on writing. Come March, we're currently talking to a couple different places to get some shows booked. We'd really like to play some new venues. One of our big things is we'd really like to do more out-of-state shows. We did a show in Indiana a couple of months ago. And we're doing another show in Indiana, but it's, like, right over the border, so that really doesn't feel like an out-of-state show.
The other one we did was Richmond, which is the other side of Indiana, the border of Ohio.
I've got ties, obviously, because I lived in Florida. I've got ties to Florida. I'd really like to get booked down there. You know, I'd like to get booked more in the Midwest. I've got friends in Michigan. I've got friends in Minnesota and Wisconsin and, you know, I'd really like to play more out-of-state shows, but I'd also really like to play a lot more local shows, play with some new local bands. There's a bunch of bands that I'm finding in our local scene that are amazing. I hear a lot of people talk about the Chicago scene, and they're like, oh, the scene's dying, you know, every band sounds the same, and it's like, you're not looking hard enough if you think every band sounds the same. I will admit there are a lot of bands that are kind of cookie
cutter. Well, I mean, like, 4 years ago, it was nothing but thrash bands.
Exactly,
so.
And now it's turning into where it's like a lot of hardcore bands are coming up, which I love hardcore music, so that's, you know, not really a big deal for me, but I know it's not for everybody. But, like, to get paid, there are so many, like, interesting, intriguing local bands. Endostalgia is a great example. Nobody is making music like they do. I'll sing Endostalgia's praises forever. They are one of my favorite bands in the local scene because nobody else is doing what they do. There's this other local band called Indisposed, and they do their stuff is like legitimate like punky like screamo stuff, and it's super cool. If you guys have never heard of them, I suggest giving them a listen. Indisposed are amazing.
Morgan, write that down.
Indisposed.
She's writing it down for me. Get it worked out, bruh.
But yeah, like I would love to play with a lot of these other bands. And then there are bands that we played with before, the guys in Wings of Severance, Bind the Sacrifice, Pretty much every band we played with, I can't really pinpoint a band that we've played with.
There's one,
I'm not going to say their name though, because they don't deserve the publicity. But they played the second show, third show, if you include the show we played without Steve and Rich. But the second show we ever played in this capacity, we played with a band that were just, they were awful.
Well, I was thinking of another one.
Oh.
If you don't have anything nice to say, don't say anything at all, so I won't name names, but we played with them twice, and both times after their set, they just hung out outside after their set.
Oh, those guys.
Yeah, and then they left. Mm-hmm. And they hung out outside after their set, and then they come up to the bands. Oh, you guys were awesome. They didn't even watch your set. So mm-hmm.
So that's one thing that, like, that irks me is, like, I show up for shows early. I watch all the bands. I don't care if I like your music or dislike your music. I'm there to support the local music. So when a band comes up to me and says, oh, dude, you guys were fucking sick, and I know for a fact that they weren't inside when we played, that irks me more than if you just walked up to me and were like, hey, man, I missed your set. Sorry.
Well, it's also this whole thing of all local bands say to each other is, oh, sick, suck, bro. Like, there's no, like, actual criticism in the scene. It's just, like, mm-hmm. everyone patting each other on the back. It's like,
and I think a big part of the reason for that is, like, you don't want to piss off the wrong band and, like...
I mean, I get that, but I've been in enough bands
I'm not disagreeing with you. I definitely feel like that's something that's kind of something that we all, as musicians, conscientiously have to, like... We have to be able to take constructive criticism. Like,
of course.
You're not going to like everything. There's 100,000 million bands out there, and you're not going to like all of them, and there's a very good chance that a band that you play with or a band in your local scene is not going to be your cup of tea. You could still be cool with them, and you could still be nice to them, and you could still be like, hey.
To be honest, I'm not the biggest fan of Synovial or Aletheia. It's not the style of metal I like, but they're still cool guys. I don't mind hanging out with them at shows.
And we love playing shows with them because we can dick around and have a good time, and we're all friends, so, you know... There are bands that we play with that I'm not the biggest fan of, but I love them as people, and, you know, you don't have to like their music to like them as people, and my whole thing is, like, if you want my honest opinion, I'll give it to you, but, you know, you have to understand that if I'm giving you my honest opinion, you can't get mad at me. If you asked me for my opinion and I give it to you, you're not allowed to get mad if it's not what you wanted to hear. Like, I really don't like bullshitting people. Like, how are you going to improve as a musician if somebody doesn't tell you that you're not doing a good job? Like, I'm not even going to say that you're not doing a good job. Like, if there's something that's really wrong, and there's a big difference between, like, not liking a certain type of music and just, like, an abrasive sound that's just not good.
Right.
And I feel like that's where people need to draw the line of, like, they're not telling you that you sound bad. They're telling you that the kind of music you're playing is not what they're into. Or if they are telling you sound bad, take that criticism into consideration, you know?
What can make us better as a band?
I would rather 100 people tell us what we can improve on than...
I think my card...
Sorry.
No, I totally understand what you're saying, and there's a fan base for every type of
genre.
Band.
Yeah. Exactly, every genre of music.
So, for instance, my brother listens to metal that sounds like it is literally recorded in a trash can.
Does he listen to black metal?
I don't know what he listens to anymore. He listens to weird things. But you know what? There's a fan base. There's an obscure fan base for everything.
Well, and that's what's really interesting about us is we all come from such, like, dynamic backgrounds. Like I was saying earlier, I kind of listen to a little bit of everything, but I definitely fall to the more, like, the core side. I definitely, like, I consider myself a deathcore vocalist simply because a lot of the styles that I use come from deathcore. Rich.
I'm a thrasher.
Rich
so.
Brick comes up through thrash.
Thrashy, baby.
I love 80s
Steve's
metal.
Got 80s metal. Justin, he's more of like a metalcore, melodic kind of sound. And Chance is just straight up caveman death metal. So, I mean, I kid you not. We call him our resident caveman because literally if it was up to him, all of our music would just be like really basic Dying Fetus style riffs and blast beats.
We make it work, though.
But that's we make it work. Like I've been in a band similar to this where like we all came from different backgrounds and it sounded like shit. So
I think it's because we all might come from different backgrounds, but we have an idea of what we want our sound to be.
We still have a common interest.
Not like we're trying to take like a song and go from like a super heavy caveman riff into some like upbeat thrash riff.
Although we do kind of do that in Persephone.
Kind of.
Persephone is a song we haven't released yet.
It's collectively the whole band's favorite song.
Yeah, it's tried and true, our favorite song. It's just so much fun to play. It's so much fun to listen to.
It's all over the place musically, but it works well. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, not a single riff repeats. It's just
yeah, and it really exemplifies each of our different styles of music. There's some, you know, deathcore influence, some death metal influence. There's this really cool part towards the end of the song where the drums come in and it literally just sounds like a pop punk drum beat. So I found a way to sneak pop punk into the song. It's pretty great. Which is funny because it comes right after this soul-crushing breakdown. So
it's a very I'd say early Slipknot askew breakdown.
Yeah, definitely.
It's toy.
We do run into some issues with our differing music styles. Like one of our new songs we wrote, which is called The Spider Queen. There's
the Spider Queen.
It's my new favorite song.
In this song, we wrote it without Rich being there.
I was sick.
He was sick, so he couldn't come to practice. And he comes in, and we start playing the song for him, and it gets to the breakdown. And Steve and I both like deathcore, so we wrote this really chuggy deathcore breakdown. And as soon as it starts, Rich makes him stop and tells him we can't play that breakdown.
Thing is, they both admitted they knew I would not let that breakdown.
We were hoping if we stuck it in with all, because the song outside of the breakdown, the song is very melodic. So, we were hoping we could slide it in there.
The thing
maybe
is, there's still a groove. Breakdown there, but it's just not so abrupt, I guess. I just didn't feel it. Not even just because I don't like deathcore that much. I just feel like it didn't fit before.
Right.
So.
But it's an awesome song. It's my favorite.
Mm-hmm. A lot of the new stuff we're writing, like Steve was saying
every
earlier,
new song we write that becomes our favorite song.
It's so true. And I don't remember if Steve said this on air or off air, but he had said that, you know, we're getting kind of tired of the stuff that we were sitting on now because we've been playing it for so long. We love all the stuff we wrote. I'm a big believer in, you know, gassing yourself up and listening to your own music and enjoying your own music. If you can't enjoy it, how do you expect anybody else to? You know what I mean? And I was actually just telling a buddy of mine who's releasing an album this year, and he's like, can I put my own EP on my top 10 favorite albums of the year? And I'm like, it'd be insulting if you didn't. If it's not your favorite album that was released this year, you're doing it wrong. A lot of great music was released this year, but Prologue's my favorite album of the year because it's my album. I wrote, and, you know, it's our album. You know, it's the first album I ever got to record professionally. It's the first time my voice has ever been recorded on music that wasn't recorded through a rock band mic on an iMac. I'm not kidding.
No, I've done that before, so
it's still now we released the album in April, and still now it's so euphoric listening to the songs and just being like,
we'll
that's,
still have people that will listen to it and then they'll come out to we played at Livewire for Fall Brawl 2. A few weeks ago, and we had someone come up. Someone came up to me. And he's like, "I checked your EP out on Bandcamp, and I really liked it. So I came out to the show, and you guys are even better live." So,
You know, not to toot our own horns or pat ourselves on the back, but something we hear a lot from people is, you know, we steal the show for every show we play, and that's what I aim for. You know,
we get a lot of good feedback.
We get a lot of good feedback. You know, we get a lot of constructive criticism as well. But
we're very energetic on stage, so it's not just us up there playing instruments.
I feel like a big part of the reason why we blow a lot of people away is because they look at us and they don't see a death metal band. You know, where I'm sure if you look at pictures of us on our Facebook page, and you look at a, you know, you're not going to look at us and say that's a death metal band. We look like a hodgepodge group of homeless people. You know, I'm a pretty big dude. I'm 6'4". I weigh 330 pounds, and I move around the stage like I'm half my size.
He's like a Mexican jumping bean. he's all over the place. He's just great.
I am. And that's something I pride myself on is the fact that despite the fact that I'm a bigger guy and I'm a bigger vocalist, you know, I can move like these littler guys like Camille from Synovial or like Jake from Aletheia.
I'd say you move more than them.
I don't know, dude. Camille has me doing crunch workouts when I go see Synovial.
Yeah, he doesn't have someone like me on stage who moves around just as much.
Rich definitely pushes me because Rich moves a lot. Everybody really everybody in the band, even Chance, who's sitting behind a drum kit, finds a way to make his movements count. And, you know, I feel like that's a big thing.
I've been playing in the local scene for close to 7 years now, and I've seen so many bands where they write awesome music and they're great to watch, but most of them are just standing there.
Yeah, they look bored.
Being robots on their instruments.
We like to rock out. We want people to notice us.
This is going to be controversial to a lot of people in the local scene because, you know, this is kind of like the way it's going. But I'm a firm believer of not using Clicks Live. I'm a firm believer of not hooking yourself up to a computer and running your whole set off of a computer because if that computer goes down, your whole set's fucked.
We've seen it happen to bands.
We've seen it happen to bands, you know, where these great bands that are tight as fuck live, the minute their computer goes down, they start sounding, you know, I'm not going to say bad, but, like, you could definitely see the dip in quality because they don't have that computer anymore. And that's where you draw the line of, is that computer accentuating what you're doing live, or is that computer a crutch?
Yeah.
You know, I don't. I've tooled with the idea of like, of playing to a click and playing live. And you know, the guys in Synovial, they're big proponents of that. And I keep bringing up Synovial because they're one of the closest bands.
They're Camille, awesome. We love them.
We do love them. Camille's a great friend of mine. I've known Camille for fucking 15 years almost at this point.
Local band.
Camille and I went to middle school together all the way up through high school, so I mean I've known him for a long fucking time. And the something he always tells me is like, you know, that's something that he's a heavy believer in, is he likes having that ability to, you know, throw in things like bass drops and stuff like that into his music. And that's cool. That's cool for like the kind of music that they make and whatever, but I feel that's not necessary for our style of music. We're a down and dirty fucking melodic death metal band. Like we don't need bass drops. We don't need.
I fall at almost every show. That's the only bass drop we need.
It's the only bass drop we need.
I move around so much. I make myself dizzy.
We
want to
be raw.
Over.
We really want to be like raw.
Yeah,
energetic.
That's the whole thing. The raw. We want the raw energy. We don't want to be worried about, you know, oh shit. We need to make sure we're staying in this tempo, in this time, and we need to keep to the click. We need to, you know, oh, this part's coming up, so we got to get ready for
it.
We
have a hard enough time getting our phones hooked up to a soundboard sometimes to play our intro track.
Literally.
So I can imagine what it's like having to bring a laptop to every show and trying to get in sync with the sound guy on getting the laptop up to speed.
Absolutely. One thing that we're looking into right now is we want to get a sample pad for the drums.
Because we have a couple samples in songs that we want to throw in.
And then for the new album, I have some ideas for samples as well. I'm a big guy. I like samples. I think it's a cool little thing that you can add in to kind of have fun with your music. You know, a lot of people kind of think it's cringy, and it is cringy if you pick really stupid things, like if you open your track with a monologue from The Dark Knight, the Joker, like that kind of shit. That's kind of cringy.
Something Morgan would do.
It's kind of cringy. Like, I'm not gonna talk down to anybody who does stuff like that. But like, I like little shit. Like, they're in one of our songs. We're not gonna play it tonight, but in one of the songs on the EP, if you want to hear it, you can pick up the EP on our Bandcamp, theeldritchgrimoire.bandcamp.com,
or just check it out on Spotify.
Or just check it out on Spotify. But you should probably buy it. Buy it from our Bandcamp, please. We're very poor.
Give
us your money.
We're gonna be dropping money on recording soon. So
yes,
our song Scarlet Syndrome. There's this scream in it.
If you ever, what's the song by Jabber Cowboy?
Entombment of a Machine.
It's kind
of
like that, where there's a break in the music, and there's a high pitched scream.
It's this blood curdling scream, and it goes right back into the music. And we want to sample that. There are other sample ideas we have, and we want to sample the intro so that we don't have to worry about setting up our mic or setting up our phones anymore. But that's about as far as I'm willing to go in that stuff. We very much like that we're a raw band, and we know that's not for everybody. But at the same time, setting yourself up on a click and playing to a click and the stuff like that isn't for everybody either. So we're happy with the sound that we have, and we're happy with the way that we play. And I don't really see that changing anytime soon.
More cowbell.
I want to get Chance.
You're
going to
add cowbell?
More cowbell.
I would love to.
More cowbell.
Just a whole breakdown of, or just
a
blast.
A whole breakdown of blast beating cowbells.
Blast beating cowbells, absolutely.
I mean, how can you not?
How can you not?
It sounds so.
Why
fun.
Haven't you already?
we're missing a golden opportunity here.
Well, before we listen to the last track that you guys brought tonight, there are a few announcements to go out with. So let's just do this rundown here. We have a few friends playing a show next weekend at the Forge, which you can buy tickets off of the locals. It is Villainous Grin, Extraction Point, Catapult, The Propaganda, and What? Playing with the infamous Battlecross.
The what?
The infamous Battle Cross.
Rich and I will be there.
Are you sure?
So you
said?
Should check that out.
You're gonna miss Battle Cross. I know you're not gonna miss Battle Cross.
Yeah. Don't delay. Also wanted to plug this weekend's show. I know that we'll be in Indiana seeing you guys play with Crusaders, but for those that are wanting to stay local at the 105 in Naperville,
we're
our friend and Witch Hammer are going to be playing with Snooze, Exofear, and From Those Ashes, and Numerical Control Society. And once again, that's the 105, that hidden alleyway venue in downtown Naperville.
Exosphere, I love those guys. Yeah. They're incredible.
From Those Ashes are really good, too.
Another
Witch
show
the shit.
Going on next weekend for you to be on the lookout for at the Fallout. It's the Night of the Living Shred featuring Inner Decay, Air Raid, Adversa, Skeletal Prison, and Sable Bedlam. And
Sable
then
Bedlam's still
Sable Bedlam is still around. Our friends in Tides Cult have physical pre-orders that are available for their debut album, Your Memory Has Tarnished This Beautiful Place. There are shirts, CDs, and bundles available. You can go to their
Boondles.
Instagram and Facebook for all of that information. And then,
yes.
But wait,
but
there's
wait.
More.
But wait.
Steven. I got a lot of but wait.
Steven, do you?
But wait.
What does that feel like? Check out El Famous's video for Judas
like I gotta poo.
Up on YouTube. Pre-orders for Blood of the Wolf's new EP, EP3, Blood Legend. It releases on November 8th, and it's available via Horror, Pain, Gore, Death Productions. You can go to their Facebook for the link for that as well. It's a little confusing, I know, but you got this.
Just going to draw a penis on your arm.
Our friends in American Sling are playing the Cubby Bear in Chicago on October 24th. Make sure you check that out. And then our friends in Guardrail and McKenna are in a contest to open up for Bayside on November 7th in Chicago. So make sure you go to BaysideBayside.com and vote for who you want to open up that show.
Propane accessories.
I don't know what that means. There is also a Halloween costume party going on this coming weekend for those that are going to be around the McChesney Park area.
McChesney Park.
You can go to Cronies Bar and Grills to see Reckless Redemption, Sound of Fire, Marks of Grey, The Martyr Complex, Faith in Vain, and a band that I cannot read their logo.
You can do it.
I cannot.
You can do it.
This is...
Who is it?
I don't know.
It's okay. You can tell me.
But
I'm
anyway,
a volunteer firefighter.
You can check that out if you were in that area. And we're also looking for more writers for those that are interested in doing reviews, written interviews with bands, and wanting to just be a part of the Metal Experience team online. You can hit us up on Facebook, themetalexperience@yahoo.com. We do have a job application that you could fill out on our Facebook page. It is a voluntary position, but you do get the perks of bands giving you their music before their release, or you get to talk to musicians, or sometimes even go to shows for free. We are just looking for people that are dedicated to maybe writing one or two reviews every month. Just because we're so busy and not everybody can write all the time. So we are looking for more volunteers. If you are interested, please contact us. And last, next week, we have guests on our show. Wait for it. Oh,
I'm
no.
waiting.
I got to figure it out.
Are they going to be as cool as us?
I mean,
are they going
I don't.
Have anticip-
do they have Steve
do they
Bukake?
Have,
they don't
they
have Speven.
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 Speben.
Speben.
Speben. Oh, Speben.
I don't know what's going on, but my thing didn't load.
We don't know what's going on next week.
Do you want me to look it up for you, Morgan?
It's not on my page for some reason.
Morgan, do you want me to look it up for you?
No.
No.
I'm missing information.
Morgan, do you want me to look it up for you?
No.
What if I told you I wasn't going to anyway?
Well, you don't have that information, sir.
I don't know how. What if?
I mean, obviously somebody's coming on the show next week. I've just
They're gonna feel really bad if they listen to this and you can't remember who they are.
Yeah, right, Morgan. Who is
okay,
it?
Okay, I booked 10 months in advance.
I'm aware.
I don't know what you want me to say. Genotype is coming on next week.
Oh, okay. That's all you had to say, Morgan.
For some reason, the event page is not on Facebook anymore. I don't know what's going on. I could have sworn
Zuckerberg.
They were here and now it disappeared.
The
so.
Duck.
I mean, I guess. So Genotype is coming back. I'm pretty sure this is like their fifth time on. They've been on quite a few times. So, yes. Looking forward to meeting them again and hanging out with them and
meeting
playing some awesome.
Meeting them again?
Some
is that
awesome
what you just
music.
Said? We're yeah. looking forward to meeting them again.
Yes.
It's always better when you meet somebody the fifth time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you looking
maybe
forward?
Then I'll remember
we're
going
to meet them again for the first time for
shut
the last
the fuck
time.
Up.
Are you looking time. Forward to meeting us again?
Steve, not you, but the rest of the band, yes.
Oh, damn.
Burn.
You yes. done pissed Morgan off. Good job.
We'll see you guys Saturday, of course, though, at yeah. 18th Street Brewery. That's going to be an awesome show.
That's really cool that you guys are coming out
we're
to that.
We're
going to
see you,
know?
You guys again.
I can't wait.
For the first time.
I'll shred extra hard for you guys.
I want you to look out in the audience, see us,
and
burp. Make sure you're shredding extra, extra hard.
I'm going
to
give a shout out to Luke. Oh, and if he doesn't take his shirt off when I shout him out, I'm kicking everybody out.
I won't be wearing a shirt to begin with.
All right. Awesome.
Oh, my God.
Even better.
I won't be wearing any underwear.
Well,
we don't need
nice.
To know that, Steve. Thanks for that
oh my God.
Knowledge.
My name is Speeben, and I'm not wearing any underwear.
Free balling.
So once again, let's talk really quickly about the next upcoming shows that you guys have, and what do you guys have available merch-wise people can buy, and where they can find you online.
So, like we said earlier, we're playing a show this weekend, October 19th. The 19th, at
18th Street Brewery.
18th Street Brewery. With
Crusadist, Dysphoria, and Hellgrind.
I'm doing this on purpose now. And then we're playing a show November 2nd. It's the last show of the year for us. We're playing Armageddon Fest. We are headlining the Jägermeister stage, which is the downstairs stage.
Jägermeister!
And you're playing with a couple of bands that we've never seen before, which is really exciting.
Yeah, I believe the bands that are playing on the same stage as us are Unity.
And Never We See?
No.
No, Until Our Last Breath.
Until Our Last Breath. I was going to say, Never We See Isn't on that show.
No,
and then
not.
It's us. But the real attraction for that show is that it's Art of the Flesh's return. And I'm not sure if you guys are too familiar with Art of the Flesh, but they've been around for a really long time, and they're amazing. I'm very, very excited to see them. And obviously our friends in Wings of Severance and Scars of Armageddon and
Beyond Death.
Lots of awesome bands in that show, and it's only $15 to get through the door. Like
7 bands, $15. Full day of metal.
Good food, because I don't care what
oh
anybody says.
God,
Penny Road makes
food. Yeah.
Such good food.
Good beer selection there, too. So.
Yeah. And as far as merch goes, we actually we don't have a whole lot. We've got a couple T-shirts. We've got our Necromancer tee, which features a necromancer. That's why we call it the Necromancer. we've got a shirt based on the song Semblance of Sincerity. It's got a pocket logo on the front. It's got the lyrics, it's a voice in the void beckoning on the back. Here I am just describing our merch, but, you know, gives you an idea of what to
I mean,
expect.
It's not currently available online anywhere. We haven't really found a way to do that yet. We'll figure it out eventually, hopefully.
But if you come out to a show, definitely. We're running a deal right now at all of our shows. If you come up to our merch table, I'll sell you a CD for $1.
$1.
$1 for a CD, you can't beat it. If you're really, really nice to me, I might even give it to you for free. But you gotta
always give them away for free. I know you do.
Or 50 cents.
We give away wristbands constantly, because I bought 300 of them and I overestimated how badly we were gonna need these, so I just literally give them away.
We literally find them all over the place at our practice space.
It's ridiculous. It's
exciting news.
I moved something out of the way and there was like 5 under it the other week. I'm like, oh my God.
We just ordered 600 wristbands and we'll
you
have them available
what?
At the November 2nd show where we sponsor Armageddon Fest. Come and get 3 new designs.
Come and get 300 wristbands.
You're going to get none.
Armageddon Fest, both of these shows, something really cool that's going on with both of these shows is this is going to be the first 2 local shows that we're going to be playing our new song Spider Queen. So that's pretty cool. We've got a couple other new songs that haven't been released yet that we're going to be playing, but we've been playing them for a while now. And then just a lot of the favorites from the EP. We got some really fun surprises for Armageddon Fest because that's our last show of the year. Some really cool stuff going on there. Other than that, I mean, like we said, after Armageddon Fest, we're really going to kind of disappear for a while. We'll be keeping up on social media. We'll post pictures.
We're just going to turn our band page into a meme page.
We're gonna be Rings of Saturn, and we're just going to meme on our band page for a couple of months and until we have some actual music to play. although unlike Lucas Mann, we don't record our stuff at half speed.
Burn.
Oof.
And that's really all we got coming up. And
yeah, we're going to be writing, we're going to be recording, and we're going to get ready for next year.
Mm-hmm. Next year, like I said, we got a lot of stuff that we want to do, whether
we're
it's all going to
take it by the balls.
Whether it's all going to pan out the way we want it to or not is
up
in the air. But we're going to try our best to do things the way that we want to do them. We really hope that people stick around and
stick
around and
my pickle with your flickle pickle.
Calm down, Lugo.
We're really hoping people stick around and continue listening and enjoying our music. And one thing that I'm really excited about is we're planning a music video for next year, which is something I've never done before. So.
Say what?
Yeah.
Nice.
And hopefully that works out the way we want it to when the time comes.
Yeah, definitely.
So the last song that we're going to hear tonight, what is it?
Flickle, pickle,
pickle.
No, Lugo.
This song is Eclipsing the God Hand, and it's a really interesting song because this is the only song I didn't write lyrics for. The lyrics for this song were written by our drummer, and this song is about... A silly Chinese cartoon that
he
likes a lot.
It's about this manga called Berserk, and it's
a silly Chinese cartoon.
It's a very dark story. It's been going on for 20 years, so it's too much to explain right now. But
it's a pretty fun song. We have a lot of fun with it. There's some interesting squeedles and deedles, and I did a lot of this was the song where I really like. Kind of wanted to show off my vocal range because it's such a long song. So this song's got a lot of different vocal techniques and stuff like that. So if you're a vocal person like me and you like to listen to vocals, this is definitely probably going to be your favorite song. But yeah, it's the only song that I didn't write lyrics for. I actually had none of us did. None of us had any...
None of us here. This was actually written before the Eldritch Grimoire was a band.
Mm-hmm. So Justin wrote this...
For his last band.
And...
They broke up, and he didn't want to scrap it because it is a great song.
So he brought it with him, and so this is the only song that none of us really touched. It's completely Justin's work, and honestly, it is one of the crowd favorites. Anyways, it's typically the song we open up with because it starts off, it punches Gung-ho. You in the face. So, yeah, enjoy Eclipsing the God Hand.
All right. Well, thank you guys so much for coming out, for taking your PTO and spending your vacation time with us. And,
yeah, I got to go to work.
Showing up late to work to be dedicated to the music. I hope that this podcast lived up to your 10-month wait.
I already can't wait.
And your New Year's resolution has come true.
My other New Year's resolution was to lose 40 pounds, and I gained 40 pounds. So,
hey, you still got 2 months.
That's unhealthy.
Jeez.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. It was really cool meeting you guys. I look forward to the next 10-month wait until we get to see you guys again.
Oh, jeez.
We're going to see you Saturday.
Yeah, we'll see you Saturday.
Yeah,
and November
really
2nd.
Fun.
Don't worry. We'll see you way before then. So until then, here is the last Eldritch Grimoire track of the night, and we'll see you again next week with our friends in Genotype back with us. So enjoy Eclipsing the God Hand.
Monsters seeking, my soul strangling.